In 1970, a television program debuted that changed the way millions of people looked at faith. The Hour of Power.
This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice.
Featuring the ministry of Robert Schuller, taught a generation that through God's love, your scars can be turned into stars. It was an idea that launched the most popular inspirational television program of its time. And today, the Hour of Power continues with a new voice for a new generation.
When you put your trust in God, nothing can stop you.
Pastor Bobby Schuller will encourage you and share a message that can give you a new perspective on life. Because whatever your circumstance or the obstacles you face, this moment can be your Hour of Power.
Is the day the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. Good morning. We're so glad that you've come today to celebrate with us here at Shepherd's Grove. Welcome to all of you watching on television on the Hour of Power. We're so glad that you're joining us wherever you are. Can we give a hand to our television congregation that's joining us today? Also want to give a special welcome to our friends from Fuller. Here we have Fred Messick and his wife, Maylin. Hi, so nice to meet you and see you again, Fred. Hi. And we have many from the international delegation. So, of course, John Townend and Helen are here, as well as Frank Hendrick and Mariana. So great to see you guys. Let's give them a hand and welcome them as well. Turn around to those who are standing next to you, greet them warmly in the name of the Lord, and say, God loves you, and so do I. Let's pray. Father, we come into your presence. We've already been in it. We recognize, Lord, that you're here, that you love us, that you want the best from us. Lord, we adore you. And we pray that as we're here, that the name of Jesus would be lifted up and glorified. It's in his name we pray. Amen.
Thank you. You may be seated. In preparation for Bobby's message today, hear these words from the Gospel of Matthew. As Jesus went on from there, he saw a man named Matthew sitting at the tax collector's booth. "Follow me," he told him, and Matthew got up and followed him. While Jesus was having dinner at Matthew's house, many tax collectors and sinners came and ate with him and his disciples. When the Pharisees saw this, they asked his disciples, "Why does your teacher eat with tax collectors and sinners?" On hearing this, Jesus said, "It is not the healthy who need a doctor, but the sick. But go and learn what this means. I desire mercy, not sacrifice, for I have not come to call the righteous, but sinners." This is the word of the Lord.
I walk with God from this day on. His loving hand will lead me on. I pray to him this humble plea. Help me, Lord, come closer to me. I walk with God all day, all night. Why should I fear while he's on my side? His love will stay forever, and he'll forsake me never. Fail me. I'm weak, but my Lord is strong. He watches over me all day long. I walk with God, he takes my hand. I talk to God, he understands, hears every word I say to him, and he knows what's in my heart as I pray. Lord God,
my guest today, and this is really a privilege, is Samuel Chand. Dr. Chand serves pastors, and you've probably heard me quote him in several of my sermons. He serves ministries, businessmen, as a leadership architect, and a change strategist. His singular vision in life is to help others succeed. He has a great story, and we're grateful to have him. Would you welcome, help me welcome Dr. Samuel Chand?
Thank you.
Hi,
thank
Sam.
You. Honored to be here. Thank you. Thank you.
You know, it really is such a great honor to have Sam here with us, and really is touching so many lives. And let's just begin. You know, you've been very successful in the way that you've helped pastors and businesses, but you came from a pretty difficult background. Am I right?
Yes. I came to the United States from India in 1973. By the way, I've been watching Hour of Power since 1973.
Yeah, great.
And I was 20 years old then. Hour of Power had that 800 number. And before I answer your question, can I just say something to you? My wife and I watch you and Hannah on a regular basis. I live in Atlanta. Your ministry is so authentic, so genuine, so warm, so engaging. And I just want to say thank you on behalf of millions who will not be able to say thank you to you and for this great church.
Yeah, thank you. I appreciate that.
So I came in the United States, 1973. I was at college. They gave me a job to be the breakfast cook, dishwasher, and janitor. Did that from 1973 to 1977. And what I did not know that the Lord had plans for my life to bring me back to the same college to be their president in 1989.
Yeah.
So God has a plan for our lives regardless of where we find ourselves today.
It's a powerful story too, because there was even some racism involved in your experience at that college.
Yes, quite a bit of it. I happen to have a better tan than my wife.
Yeah, better tan.
Yes, a better tan. Yes, it just depends on which oven you come out of, you know? And yeah. So she's doesn't look like me. And you can understand this is early 70s. This is the Deep South. This is Atlanta. Yep. So a lot of things were going on at that time. So I went through some very, very dark and difficult days. But you got to just hold on to what God has for you, and thank God. I've been married to her now for 36 years, for which I'm very, very grateful.
Well, the reason that story is so powerful is that, you know, you're an Indian man and your wife is white, and you were dating and you loved each other, and the school was sort of against you being together, and it's like one of those classic fairy tales. But the great thing about that is I love the way you responded to really what was an injustice. You weren't a victim. You weren't, at least what I read in your book, it didn't seem like you're angry. In fact, you overcame that, came back to even become the president. I mean, that's like the best, like, you know, best revenge, right? I mean, yeah, sensational. But that speaks to your character and really your philosophy, doesn't it?
That's the funny part is that the gentleman who was interested in reading me the Riot Act, because Brenda and I were not allowed to talk, so we exchanged notes. So we got boxes of notes.
Yeah.
We are embarrassed to read them now, but we got boxes of notes. And and so when I went back to be a president, he ended up working for me. you know, the Bible says, vengeance is mine, says the Lord.
Yeah.
I was quite disappointed in the Lord. He was not doing a good job.
Yeah.
I had to help him along a little bit there, but... It's just God has a plan that you look back on it and say, wow, that had to be God. But when you're going through it, it's the hardest time to trust him when you cannot see him.
Yeah, that's right. You know, one of the great things about this interview is one of the first times I've had an opportunity to interview somebody about a book I've already read. And Leadership Pain, which is on your knees right now, you're holding that book, was such a help for me. And the principle of Sam's book in Leadership Pain is that your ability to lead is equal to your threshold for pain. Maybe that's in Bobby's words. Mm-hmm. That to lead and to be a difference maker in the world, you also have to have a healthy way of coping with pain. And you have to recognize that pain is just a part of succeeding. And of course, you've experienced a tremendous amount of pain in your life. And that numbing the pain is one of the worst things you can do.
That's right. Because of my travel and working with churches and corporations, sacred, secular, doesn't matter, the greatest differentiating factor that I discovered for people to go to the next level of their destiny and succeed is their ability to handle more pain. Mm-hmm. And so the simple thesis is that you will grow only to the threshold of your pain. The difference between a CEO of a smaller corporation, larger corporation, smaller church, larger church, is the ability to handle pain.
Yeah.
And so like you said, if we end up numbing our pain, the first chapter is called Leadership Leprosy.
Yeah.
In which we try to numb our pain and try to get away from it, because everything wants to gravitate towards pleasure and run from pain. But once we discover that pain is a friend, pain informs us, pain mm-hmm. can transform us. So if this was a hot stove and I put my hand on it but couldn't feel the pain, my fingers would burn up.
Yep.
But because I feel the pain, I can remove my hand. And that is why I think there's something important that we have to remind ourselves that the pain we are going through is really a developmental process
yeah.
to take us to where God has for us.
Yeah, I mean, there was something, I think the method, it was almost like a mathematic formula. Let me see if I get this right. Growth equals change. Change equals
loss.
Loss? Oh, say it for us.
Okay. There will be a test, huh?
Yeah, okay.
So in the book, I talk about that growth equals change. Second line is change equals loss.
Yeah.
Third line is loss equals pain. Therefore, all growth is about pain. We call that growing pains.
Yeah.
So be it at a church, be it at a corporation, there are different levels of pain, and unless you can break through those pain thresholds, pain barriers, you cap yourself, and your capacity to handle more pain is the only thing that'll help you increase.
Now, you also used to be a pastor. Put your pastor hat on for a minute, okay?
But the Lord has delivered me.
Yeah, that's good.
He let me out early for good behavior.
Oh, that's good, yeah. You know, many people who are watching or on television or many who are here in the church today, they would ask, is the reverse true? So you say that in order to grow, we have to experience pain. But is pain always a good thing? Like, many people here are experiencing chronic health pain. You know, Hannah and I experienced the pain of seeing our son have his own health problems last year. Very painful experience. Many people go through pain and loss. Is pain always a good thing, or?
Pain is not necessarily a good thing, but pain is necessary to life.
Yeah.
I don't think there's any such thing as avoiding pain. Even our Lord and Savior, at the end in Garden Gethsemane, he asked the Father to remove the pain from him.
Yeah.
And I know we like to preach about the second part of that verse, nevertheless, thy will be done, not mine. But the first part is still where we live.
Yeah.
In the, you know, we can sing about the sweet by and by, but we live in the nasty now and now.
Yep.
Yeah, so it's a very difficult time. I was holding back my tears because about 3 years ago, we buried our grandson. And then after that, we had a grandbaby, a daughter, you know? So how do you embrace the pain, know that God is at work, that nobody in the Bible, including his own son, was exempt from pain.
Mm-hmm.
It was necessary that he go through Calvary. And so no, pain is not necessarily good, but it's necessary.
Necessary. I wrote, when I was reading your book, I wrote, only living things experience pain.
I'll have to write that again. Yeah.
Yeah, as I was thinking through it, numbness is associated really with being dead. In fact, anesthesia actually means in Greek, it means resurrection, because anesthetics means to make an area essentially dead, and so that you don't experience the pain. So pain and life are, in a way, associated.
Yeah, and I don't think, it doesn't matter how saved you are and how much you love Jesus.
Yeah.
We sometimes collate pain to, I might have done something wrong, or pain to there's sin in my life, or pain to I'm reaping of something somewhere that was sown in my life. Pain is just because we live. It is just part of life. But so is development part of life. So is knowing what God has for us part of life.
Yeah.
But you cannot avoid the, you have to go, yea, though I walk through the valley of shadow of death, I will fear no evil. There's no bridge around it. There's no tunnel under it. There's no detour around it. You will go through the valley of shadow. But the good thing is that thou art with me.
That's right.
And that's what we hold on to at all times.
Well, Sam, thank you. And that's really an encouraging word for all of us, that even though you're going through pain, pain is a part of life. And know that the God we serve will help you get through those difficult times in your life. The book is Leadership Pain. His name is Sam Chan. We hope that you get the book, read it. It's so, so helpful, whether or not you're in leadership. It's a book that was just, it really touched my heart deeply. Sam, thank you so much. Let's give him a hand and welcome him and thank him for being
thank
here.
You.
God
thank
bless
you, Bobby.
You.
Thank you.
So grateful for your time.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
When I think I'm going under, part the waters, Lord. When the waves are crashing round me, calm the sea. When I cry for help, oh, hear me, Lord. Hold on your hand, touch my life, calm the raging sea.
Music here is very good, no doubt about it. It's that, you know, pastor's favorite time of the service when we collect money. You know, that's the, honestly, as a pastor, sometimes is the most awkward part of the service. Really, what we do when we take and collect tithes and offerings, it's a time of worship. Very often, especially if you haven't been to church, or maybe if you've been at the wrong church, this time sometimes feels like church tax. You know, it's the time in which it's time for me to give my dues, and we don't want you to feel that way about giving. First of all, there's no obligation at all to give. Rather, this is an opportunity for you to invest into something you love. If you love this ministry and you want to get behind it, you want to see more people reached by it, then give. If you want this to be an opportunity to say to the Lord, Father, thank you for the things that you've given back to me. I'm going to give a small bit back to others just to show you that I recognize that what I have is yours, then now is the time to do that. Friends, thank you for all of you who have continued to support our ministry and our church. Hope you know we love you, and we want to do whatever we can to be responsible with all of the things God has given us. Amen.
Pastor Bobby is passionate about being and helping you to be a happy and whole student of Jesus. Each week before his teaching, he encourages everyone to recite a confession statement as a way of opening up their hearts to God. Today, Pastor Bobby wants to send you an accent pillow with the words from the weekly confession, I'm not what I do. I'm not what I have. I'm not what people say about me. I am the beloved of God. Memorize and pray through these statements and watch your life change. For your gift of $25, we will send you this 9.5 by 11 inch cotton canvas decorative pillow. Call, write, or go online today. Thank you. And remember, as always, God loves you, and so do we.
Through so many dangers and toils of this life, I have already come, and he keeps on giving the grace and the strength to just keep pressing on. He's given a promise, and I am gonna stand on every word his hope. Whatever lies ahead.
Thank you. Thank you, guys. That was amazing. And that's a good message, too. You are going to make it. Many of us, we just need to hear that sometimes. And we get stuck in a rut in life, we get these health problems or money problems or family problems, we think, I can't make it. And it's a good reminder that we serve a good God who will carry us through. Can we get an amen?
Amen.
Amen. All right. A few things. Number one, follow me on Twitter. If you have a phone and you have Twitter and you want to live tweet this sermon, that's cool. You can do that. In fact, I really like it. In fact, if you're watching at home on Hour of Power on Saturday night or Sunday morning, it's very likely, especially at Saturday night, that I'm just sitting around and my phone will bleep and you'll say something on Twitter. I will respond to everyone at least once. I love questions, love comments, love to engage, and love getting to know people on Twitter. Number two, if you're ever in town, for those of you watching at home, near Disneyland, Anaheim, Orange, Garden Grove, where we are here, come visit us. We'd love to meet you. Come and worship with us. We'd love to give you a big old hug and know where you're from and get to know you better. All right, would you stand with me? We're going to say this confession together. Maybe hold your hands out like this. This is a sign of receiving God's love. We're going to say it together. I'm not what I do. I'm not what I have. I'm not what people say about me. I am the beloved of God. It's who I am. No one can take it from me. I don't have to worry. I don't have to hurry. I can trust my friend Jesus and share his love with the world. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. Yeah, that's the truth. We're going to take some time over the next few weeks to dig into the perils of Jesus and use a narrative, even our imagination, to remember many of the stories that are told in the Gospels so that we can sort of, like the disciples, find ourselves following and sort of living in Jesus' world. Before I get to the passage today, I want to tell a story. I think my dad mentions it at the beginning of one of his books, Walking in Your Own Shoes. When my grandpa, Schuller, some of you have heard of him, when he was a boy, I was like 9 or 10, he was a terrible farmer. And his brother used to tease him about it all the time. His father, my great-grandfather, Anthony, used to pray that someday in the Schuller family, there would be what they called a domine. Now, in the Dutch communities of the Midwest, they would speak a mixture of both Dutch and English. There would be these farming communities that were deeply religious. And even though it was under the governance of the state or under the governance of Washington, D.C., and they had laws and things, there was sort of an undergirding religious law that those Dutch people who lived in the 20s, 30s, and 40s in these little Dutch farming communities, that even though they could go to the local jurisdiction for whatever kind of discrepancies or arguments they'd have with one another, they would actually go to the domine. The domine was the local pastor. And that local pastor was the guy who would sort of make the big decisions about who was right and who was wrong. He would sort of regulate the local community. And it was considered in these little Dutch communities sort of a position of highest honor. There was no greater honor than to be a domine. And so it was actually my great-grandfather Anthony's prayer and dream that someday there would be a domine in his family. And there was. It was my grandpa. He was the first one. And sure, you can clap. Yeah. Now there's been lots of domine Schullers, like yours truly. So you guys don't have that same esteem for me, you know? Come on. It was like, I'm just kidding. Don't sue each other. Just come to me. I'll figure it out for you, you know? But this this position of high esteem, you know, that was held in the Midwest, this also existed in Israel in Jesus' day for the rabbis. Although there was this local Roman law and Herodian law that the rabbis were really the positions of greatest honor, and really very often the rabbis would be the ones that would make some of the big key decisions in the local areas in Israel. Let's read the passage real quick. It's from the Gospel of Matthew chapter 9. As Jesus went from there, he saw a man named Matthew. Keep in mind, it's Matthew that's writing the story. Saw a man named Matthew sitting at a tax collector's booth. "Follow me," he told him. And Matthew got up and he followed him. And while Jesus was having dinner at Matthew's house, many tax collectors and sinners came and ate with him and his disciples. When the Pharisees saw this, they asked his disciples, "Why does your teacher eat with tax collectors and sinners?" On hearing this, Jesus said, "It is not the healthy who need a doctor, but the sick. But go and learn what this means. I desire mercy, not sacrifice. For I have not come to call the righteous, but I've come to call sinners." You know, the Jewish people had such a love, and still do, for Torah. Torah was the first five books of the Bible. And it was, for the Jewish people in Jesus' day, the Torah was the greatest honor. It was God's word. They loved God's word. They loved the Bible. They wanted God's word to be at the center of everything in their life. They wanted to study it, to know it, to use it to make every single decision. They loved to debate it, to make art about it, to think about it. And they had a whole structure built around Torah. When Torah came out in the synagogue, they would dance around and sing and rejoice, like bouncing the scrolls up and down in the air like it was a party because they had the Bible. I wish we did that. You know, they'd be like, "God's word, God's word, God's word," you know, like, we should do, you know, we're all so often like,
"Open your Bibles, Matthew chapter 9.
No, they were so thrilled about the scriptures, about God's word. This was this gift given to them about how to live God's way. They believed if one generation forgets Torah, then everything could fall apart. And so they would begin with little children. They would say, "We want to stuff our children with Torah like you would stuff an ox," you know? And so they began at age 5 to teach children the Torah, to begin a process of actually memorizing the first 5 books of the Bible. They would use that for all of their learning, not just religious learning. They would use it to teach them how to write. They would use it to teach them how to tell stories, how to do all of these things. And so it became the center of education and therefore the center of social life for the Jewish people. Built into that system was a system of rabbis who debated and discussed the word with one another. And to be a rabbi in the first century and in Jesus' day was a tremendous honor, huge honor, one of the greatest honors you could have within Jewish society. And very often, these students that would begin at 5, the very best of the best, would think that they were so good at Torah and at understanding God's word and the law and the prophets that they would seek after another rabbi that would mentor them because they themselves would want to become a rabbi themselves. And so they would go, usually long distances, risking, you know, life and limb to find some rabbi to see if he would take them under his learning. And so they would travel and they would find this rabbi and they would ask him, "May I follow you? May I take your yoke upon me?" A rabbi's yoke was his interpretation of the Bible. You might call it his denomination. And so every rabbi that was well known would have a certain way of interpreting scripture, and he would want disciples, and those disciples' jobs would be to become like clones of the rabbi. The rabbi would want these disciples, these talmidim, to be just like him in every way. And so he would pick these young teenage boys, and they would follow him, and they would do everything like him, because the rabbi, you see, he'd pick the best of the best, and he would say, "You guys can do everything that I do. Not only can you, but you ought to, and you will." And so most of the time, when some great student went before a rabbi and asked to learn from him, very often the rabbi would reject the student. He would say, go and ply your trade. Go and do what your dad does. You are not good enough to be my disciple. You're not smart enough. You're not good looking enough. You're not tall enough or short enough or fat enough or skinny enough. You need to go. Rabbis always, I think, this is Bobby now, I think rabbis really wanted to just pick a hand, you know, hand-select few of students that would really up their own reputation. You know what I mean? You want the best looking, the smartest, the brightest, the Harvard of students. But every once in a while, some student would find a rabbi, and the rabbi would say these powerful words to him. The rabbi would say, "Follow me. Follow me." And when that happened, that meant you were accepted to become like this rabbi. When a rabbi said to you, "Follow me," he's saying, "I think you are good enough to be like me and to do the things I can do. I believe that you can be like me. I think you're good enough." That's powerful. And if a boy would be called in this way, to be like the rabbi, he would go before his father and tell his father about what would happen. And there was this sort of famous line, Ray Vanderlyn talks about it a lot. The father would say to his boy, who's no longer going to be a fisherman, no longer going to be a blacksmith or whatever, he's going to be a rabbi, he would say to his son, "May you be covered in the dust of your rabbi." The idea being that you'd always have this rabbi, and like little ducklings, you would have little teenage boys following behind him, asking him questions, learning from him about Torah. What a huge honor it was for first century Jewish men to have a boy that was good enough, smart enough to become a disciple. One of the highest positions of honor in Jesus' day would have been a rabbi. Jesus, of course, was a rabbi. He was called that multiple times. But probably the worst position, I mean, probably the very worst was a Samaritan, but only slightly better than that. I mean, one of the worst of the worst were the tax collectors. I mean, tax collectors were the vermin, the scum of the earth. Nothing has changed, right? We all love tax collectors now. You know, but back then, they didn't have the respect we have for the IRS. So tax collectors were the bottom of the barrel. I mean, they were the worst. They were the worst. There was a nationalistic sort of undergirding to why tax collectors were so hated. Again, in Jesus' day, there was a fanatical nationalism in Israel. You had a Jewish people that wanted to see essentially a theocracy in Israel, where the religious order was also the government, where God was king over Israel. And instead of that, they had these white guys from Italy, the Roman Empire, dominating them, overseeing them, occupying their houses, doing all of their pagan practices, all of their pagan things that they do in the midst of these very clean, holy Jewish people, and it drove them nuts. And they believed that when a Messiah would come, that this Messiah would sort of usher out these rotten Italians and free them and give them this sort of new theocracy. And so there was this fanatical nationalism that was sort of undergirding the Israeli people today. You had these tax collectors who were Jewish that worked for Rome, you see? Not only did they work from Rome, they were extortionists. So the system, not wise, the system that was set up was essentially that the tax collectors would go around and collect taxes from the locals for income tax and all sort of import, export tax and whatever. And then in order to pay themselves, they would sort of like add a little extra and not say how much that extra was. And then use Roman muscle to get the money out of people. That makes sense? So imagine like you've got this Jewish guy who's sided with Rome, who's going around to like Jewish widows and like orphans, and he's sort of like that wolf, a sheriff of Nottingham, you know, on the Robin Hood cartoon, like where he takes the guy's cast and he like hits it to get a little coin out of it. So you had these rotten tax collectors that sort of sided with Rome, and so they were hated. They were grouped in oral tradition with all of the vile beasts mentioned in Leviticus 20. They were banned from the synagogue, meaning they were not allowed to be a part of normative Jewish worship life. They weren't allowed to come to church, ever. They weren't allowed through the doors. They were hated. So take this character, Matthew. Here he is. He's you know, sitting at a table or something, and he's a tax collector. He's probably doing what his dad has done, what his dad's dad has done. He and very likely his whole family are outcasts. They've probably never gone to synagogue. They probably don't know much about Torah at all. They've probably always sort of sided with Rome. Very likely all of his friends are sinners, and he's probably got friends like Samaritans and tax collectors and prostitutes and those that aren't allowed to go to church. He's not your normal religious guy. He's spiritually bankrupt. Now, remember what we said about rabbis and the calling of rabbis. And remember what we said about tax collectors and how rotten and horrible they were. The most hated, disrespected, unliked person in society on one hand, and the most honored, revered person on another. And what happens? Jesus goes to Matthew the tax collector, and he says these powerful words. He says, "Follow me." You could probably could have heard the air in the room evaporate as everybody Remember, only the best of the best, the brightest of the brightest, the holiest of the holiest could follow rabbis. And here's this Jesus who goes before a tax collector and says, "I think you're good enough. I think you can be like me. I think you can be changed like me. I think you can do the things that I do. I think you can be a man of God." Imagine the power of that. Jesus calls a man that everyone hates to be in the most honored, respected position in Jewish society. He calls him to be his Talmid, to be his student, to follow him, to be covered in his dust. He breaks the chain, possibly, of father and son, tax collector, extra tax collector, being outside of God's kingdom. He invites him in to the blessing of God's covenant and Torah life. Isn't that powerful? And how does Matthew respond? He's like, knocks the table over, coins going everywhere. "Yes, Lord, I'll follow you." And then what does he do? He gets all of his sinner, rejected friends together at a party to throw his new, you know, he's got this new life he's going to begin as a Talmid of Jesus, Rabbi Jesus. He's going to follow Jesus. And so he gets all of his hooker friends, right? And he gets all of his, like lepers and Samaritans, and they all gather. And even worse, Jesus goes and sits with them and eats with them and breaks bread and drinks wine with them. And people are saying, "Oh, this guy, you know, Jesus, he might be a prophet. He might be Elijah returned. He's this incredible rabbi, famous. Thousands of people are following him. And look at who he's sitting with. Look at who he's eating with." And that's a big deal in his day, too. Like, to eat with someone is to, like, call them family, like a brother or a sister. He's eating with them. He's embarrassing his other disciples. "Rabbi, you called a tax collector, and then you sat and ate with his friends? Don't you know who she is, Rabbi? Don't you know who that man is, Rabbi?" Here's the thing. Wherever you are in life, Jesus is saying to you, in the midst of your sin, in the midst of your brokenness, in the midst of your rejection, "Follow me." He's saying, "I think you're good enough. I think you're smart enough. I think you're good looking enough. I think you're wise enough. I think you can be like me." Isn't that great news? Jesus says to all of us, no matter how old we are, no matter how young we are, no matter what our baggage is, no matter what we're wrestling with, you can be like him. In fact, more than that, he says, "Greater things than these will you do." Do you believe that? You know, we claim that we're saved by faith. And Matthew believed what Jesus said about him, and it was accredited to him as righteousness. Matthew believed that when Jesus said to him, "You can be like me," he believed it with all of his heart and carried it with him to the grave. And God called it righteousness. We have faith in what people say, but we usually don't have faith in the things that God says. We put our faith in all the horrible things that people say about us. We believe the horrible things our dad or mom or our grandparents or siblings or children or coworkers or society, we believe the things they've said about us, and we haven't had faith in the things that God has said about us. We've put faith in those horrible things and believed it, and it's taken root in our lives. No more. Stop having faith in the horrible things that people say about you and start believing and have faith in what Jesus says about you, that you can be like him, you can be his Talmid, you can follow him, and you can do the great things that he did in this world. Scriptures say that we're saved by faith. It's faith alone that rescues us, not our good works. Only faith in the cross and resurrection and ascension of Jesus. We don't have faith in that, then we're doomed. Many of us, we don't know what faith means, and yet we're practicing it all the time. My guess is most of you had faith when you sat down in those pews that it wasn't going to fall from under you. I didn't have that because I had In-N-Out for dinner last night. You know, I'm the fattest I've ever been right now. That's all right. No, but you have faith in things all the time. You have faith that your chair is not going to break. You don't check it and look to see, make sure all the screws are right, or you just sit in it. You have faith when you eat out at a restaurant that a cook isn't going to give you bad food or he's not going to poison it, right? You don't check it. You don't have some taster go with you and make sure that it's not messed up, right? And that's what faith is. Faith is trusting that God is who he says he is and believing that God will do what he says he would do. When you have faith, here's a great example of faith. When you get on an airplane, look, here's what I really want you to hear. Many of us, when we get on an airplane, we get a little scared. You know, you get a little worried, you may say a little prayer. Maybe you do your lucky thing. You put your hand on the little plane when you get in. That's what I used to do. I stopped doing it. I felt like I was being superstitious. You do these little things to make sure the plane, and yet the plane is the safest way to travel. It's safer than driving. It's even safer than walking. You have that knowledge, and yet it's not good enough, is it, when you get on a plane? There's still you definitely feel safer walking than you do getting on a plane going across the ocean. And what I want to say to you is that when you get on a plane, you sit down and you buckle up, even if you're afraid, you have enough faith to fly. You hear what I said? When you get on a plane, you sit down, and you buckle your seatbelt, and you get on a plane and you go, even though you're scared, you have enough faith to fly. You do not have to have all of the faith in the world to be a disciple. You just need a mustard seed. You just need enough to sit down and put your seatbelt on. That's it. If you've got that, you've got enough to be saved. You've got enough to be a Talmid. You've got enough to heal the sick. You've got enough to be like Jesus, to be like him in every single way, to have a new heart, to be completely transformed in his likeness. That's how we're saved, is by faith. Doesn't mean you're not going to be scared. Doesn't mean you're not going to be afraid. Doesn't mean you're not going to even doubt. What it means is I just need enough faith to sit down and put my seatbelt on. No matter who you are, no matter how pious and self-righteous and religious you are, or how down and out and poor and sinful you are, you can become like Jesus. You can be like him. You can follow him. And you can follow his ways. And that is very, very good news. And so I want to do something for a minute here. I want you to close your eyes with me. I started doing this every week because I just feel like, I know it's a church and most of us are Christians, but sometimes some of us will come here and we just need the opportunity to say yes to Jesus, to just sit down and put the buckle on. And so I want to offer you here in the church and all of you watching on television the opportunity to say yes to the rabbi's call to follow him. If you want to be a disciple, if you're sitting here in this church and you want to be a disciple, I'm not going to ask you to stand. I'm not going to ask you to raise your hand. I'm not going to ask you to come forward. This is between you and God. I'm going to ask you to simply say, yes, Lord, I will follow you. And if you do that and you believe it to be true, you will be saved. And this may be the last opportunity. You never know it could happen. This may be the last chance you have to say yes to the Lord, to say no to the world, and to say yes to him, that you're going to be a light in the world, you're going to be salt, you're going to live for others, you're going to be like Jesus in everything you do. You want to be justified, saved, redeemed. You need a fresh start. If that's you, then I want you to pray this, and you don't have to say it out loud. I'm going to pray this prayer, and I want you to sort of align your heart and your mind with this prayer. And then I want all of us to say amen, and when you say amen, that's a way of saying this is my prayer too. And so, Lord, help me. Forgive me of my sin. I don't know everything about the Bible. I don't know everything about God or Jesus. But Lord, I have just enough faith to believe that you can save me. I want to become a disciple. Forgive me of my sin. Redeem me. Renew me. I want to be your student. Lord, I love you. In Jesus' name, amen. May you be covered in the dust of your rabbi. Amen. And now, the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord cause his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift his countenance upon you and give you peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Pastor Bobby is passionate about being and helping you to be a happy and whole student of Jesus. Each week before his teaching, he encourages everyone to recite a confession statement as a way of opening up their hearts to God. Today, Pastor Bobby wants to send you an accent pillow with the words from the weekly confession, "I'm not what I do. I'm not what I have. I'm not what people say about me. I am the beloved of God." Memorize and pray through these statements and watch your life change. For your gift of $25, we will send you this 9.5 by 11 inch cotton canvas decorative pillow. Call, write, or go online today. Thank you. And remember, as always, God loves you, and so do we.
Join us again next week as Pastor Bobby Schuller brings you a message of hope on the Hour of Power. And when you visit our website, you'll discover books, devotionals, and other resources to take your Christian life to a new level. And Pastor Bobby would love to hear from you. Just write us. And when you do, consider supporting this incredible ministry on a regular monthly basis. We're taking a life-changing message literally around the world. And your regular financial support makes all the difference. Until next week, remember to let your hopes, not your hurts, shape your future.